Welcome to everybody here. We couldn't be more thrilled to have you here. The style for lightning talks is we're going to do no intros because you can look everybody up online. We don't do any Q&A. If you're interested in the topic or the speaker, please come meet them afterwards, get to know them. And the talks will all be about 10 minutes so that we can get through the five in our allotted 1 hour and get to the coffee break right on time. So I'll say at the outset, one of the most daunting things for any government official is to come to an internet conference and do things like lightning talks. And so I give a tremendous degree of credit to Dr. Thomas Fitchin, our first speaker, for being willing to come into this peculiar environment and start us off with a talk on Germany, next steps at the UN for the right to privacy in the digital age. Thank you, Dr. Fitchin.
Yeah, thank you very much for the welcome and for inviting me to the conference. The purpose of my talk is really to introduce everyone to not only the latest texts that have evolved at the UN in the General Assembly and the Human Rights Council resolution on the right to privacy in the digital age was adopted just last Friday, so it's really fresh off the press, but also to give you a little bit of background so that you can interpret and understand this long-term effort that is run by Brazil, Germany, and a couple of other close allies at the Human Rights Council and the General Assembly in parallel to work in favor of the protection of privacy. So, first a little bit on how to understand all the pile of paper that we already have, the legal basics. A general saying since the first resolutions, the same rights that people have offline must be protected online. And also, both texts have reaffirmed over many versions that the right to privacy means that nobody shall be subjected to arbitrary or unlawful interference. Please remember these three words, arbitrary or unlawful interference, because they are the red thread that runs through all the text. General Assembly has also emphasized that unlawful arbitrary surveillance, as well as unlawful arbitrary collection of personal data, violate the right to privacy. So that's the legal core. If it's unlawful or arbitrary in terms of surveillance, it does violate human rights. And that's important to understand because it shows up in various contexts throughout all the texts that we have adopted in both bodies. Then both texts say that surveillance of digital communications must be consistent with international human rights obligations and must be, and this is a kind of qualification, based on a legal framework that is public, accessible, clear, precise, comprehensive, and non-discriminatory, and that any interference must not be arbitrary and or unlawful. So you need to do it on the basis of a legal framework. And then, of course, both the General Assembly and the Human Rights Council expressed their concern that the negative impact that surveillance or interception, including extraterritorial surveillance, in particular when carried out on a mass scale, may have on the exercise. It doesn't say are against human rights or do violate. They may have consequences for the exercise and enjoyment of human rights. So it's an indication of what may be the case, but it's not a legal statement in that sense. Third point, again, in different words, emphasizing that states must respect international human rights obligations regarding the right to privacy when they do intercept communications. So the underlying logic is intercepting digital communications may be allowed, may be possible, may even be necessary, but of course only if it is done in the context of international human rights obligations. Now, what are these justifications that I've just mentioned? The text mentions two. One, concerns about public safety may justify the gathering and protection of certain sensitive information. And also prevention and suppression of terrorism is a public interest of great importance. And making sure that states take any measures to combat terrorism are in compliance with their obligations under international law. The interesting thing is, it's not about precedence. It doesn't say that the interest of fighting terrorism has always precedence over human rights. No, that's not what it says. It says if measures are taken, they have to be in compliance with international law. So no ranking between the two. I skip that one due to the lack of time that we have. We have a new language on metadata and automated processing, where the Human Rights Council notes that metadata, when aggregated, can reveal personal information that can be no less sensitive than the actual content. And also a concern expressed by the Human Rights Council that automatic processing of personal data may lead to discrimination or decisions that violate or affect the enjoyment of human rights. So that's an indication about automated processing. It's not a statement on it, but it indicates where the problems may be. There's also one paragraph that I think many of you are particularly interested in, namely on human rights defenders and journalists. One is that persons, organizations against engaged in promoting and defending human rights do face threats and harassment and suffer insecurity as well as unlawful and arbitrary interference. And another one, which comes from a different resolution, I mean the resolution, the latest one on safety of journalists, that says that in the digital age, encryption and anonymity tools have become vital for many journalists to carry out their job. So that's also an indication about two groups of people that are particularly in need of strong privacy protection. Now, what is the consequence of this? First of all, for states, states are called upon by the General Assembly and the Human Rights Council to respect and protect the right to privacy. Very simple, it follows from what we have said earlier. And the Human Rights Council also recalls that states have to ensure that any interference with the right to privacy is consistent with the principles of legality, necessity, and proportionality. So it's there's a link between this paragraph and the earlier ones that I have quoted. So conditions are not exactly being piled on top of each other, but the framework is being spelled out by this language. Now, states, when they carry out surveillance, they're called upon to establish or maintain independent, effective, adequately resourced, and impartial judicial, administrative, and or parliamentary domestic oversight mechanisms. That's the whole point, that there are mechanisms that do control and do watch this surveillance while it is being carried out. Doesn't go into the details, but you have the qualifications in the text. Second, there is also a call to provide individuals whose rights to privacy has been violated by unlawful or arbitrary surveillance, must have access to an effective remedy. And finally, states are called upon to maintain and implement adequate legislation with sanctions and remedies that protects individuals against violations and abuses of the right to privacy, namely through unlawful and arbitrary collection, processing, retention, etc., by governments, no surprise, but also by individuals, business enterprises, and private organizations. So the context is being expanded a little bit to cover also other players. What adequate legislation is of course up to each state to decide, but the Human Rights Council invites and calls upon all governments to have this type of language. States should also are also called upon to refrain from requiring business enterprises to take steps that interfere with the right to privacy in an arbitrary or unlawful way. So the threshold, as you can see, this is the sixth or seventh time that this term is coming up. The threshold is arbitrary or unlawful. States are also invited to consider measures that would enable business enterprises to adopt adequate voluntary transparency measures. Here we are moving into a field that has been discussed lately quite a lot. Transparency about requests addressed by states, by governments, to providers and other internet companies to lay open certain information, to provide information. How does the public know about this? So here, states are invited to consider appropriate measures that do enable business enterprises to adopt adequate voluntary measures. It's a starter. It's lots of conditions, voluntary, adequate, appropriate, but I think the direction is becoming clear. Finally, states are invited to develop and maintain legislation for the sale or resale or other corporate sharing of personal data without free, explicit, and informed consent. What is new in both texts is really a move towards also the business side of the equation, namely to talk about the role of business enterprises. General Assembly has welcomed measures taken by business enterprises on a voluntary basis, of course, to provide the kind of transparency that I just mentioned to their users about their policies regarding requests, not individual cases, but policies in the first place. And General Assembly and the Human Rights Council call on government, on business enterprises to meet their responsibility to respect human rights in accordance with the famous guiding principles and to inform users about collection, use, sharing, and retention of their data and to establish transparency policies as appropriate. Human Rights Council, human rights violation is normally something that governments are doing, that states are doing, but here both texts contain an element on the role of business enterprises. Business enterprises, the private sector, are also encouraged to work towards enabling secure communication and the protection of individual users. That's the General Assembly, half a year ago last fall. Now, the latest text last Friday is a bit more precise on this. Human Rights Council says, encourages business enterprises to work towards enabling technical solutions to secure and protect the confidentiality. This is a lot more precise than the other one. And two of the means that, one of the means that is expressly listed in the text is measures for encryption and anonymity. Of course, there's no prescription to do it. It may include measures of that kind. Getting to my last slide, because many countries in the both General Assembly and the Human Rights Council want to continue, there will be an expert workshop organized by the High Commissioner for Human Rights before the 37th session. And since all of you are in the room, civil society organizations, academia, human rights institutions, business enterprises, technical community and others, you're all invited to participate in that workshop. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Thomas Fitchin from the Federal Foreign Office of Deutschland. That's very enlightening. Moving on, our next talk, lightning talk, will be from Julian Ranger from Digi.me, solving personal data privacy issues by sharing more the Internet of Me. Take it away, Julian.
Good afternoon. So I'm Julian Ranger from Digi.me, at RangerJ and at Digi.me. What I'm going to talk about is exactly what we've just had on the screen. So how do businesses respect your data? How do we continue to get all of the things we want from businesses and more with privacy? And I'm going to try and convince you that actually with one change, very simple change, we can share more with greater privacy. Okay, so we'll see whether I'm successful in that. So if we think about sharing today, we're on a seesaw. If I share more, by tendency, my privacy goes down because people have my data and they don't respect it and it goes wrong. So if I want to tilt that seesaw the other way and have greater privacy, then I have to share less. But if I share less, then I'm not going to get the services and the things that I want from businesses. I'm not going to be able to use new data, whether that's genomic data or health data, whether that's my finance data, or my social, my browsing, my purchases, whatever it may be. So there's a lot we could do if only we could solve that conundrum. So how do we get off the seesaw? Because being on the seesaw doesn't work. And the answer is actually very simple. We return the data to the individual so that the individual owns and controls their data, actually has it available on their own phone or any other device. So how do you do that? Well, I could come to you as Digi.me and say, hey, trust me, I'm a great company. Give me all your login details and your OAuths and I'll go and get all of your data from your health, your hospitals and GPs and your social data and your banks and I'll put it all into a lovely repository for you and you can trust me to hold that for you. I don't think you would, right? I would just become a super Google or somebody else. And I couldn't secure it even if I wanted to. So what we do is something very different. You get it yourself. So in fact, with our solution, you download our software, Digi.me, to your device. You decide what data you want, whether that's your social data, your bank, your health, whatever it may be. And the data will then be sucked down by that software directly from the source, directly to your device, and in fact, your personal cloud, you can choose any one of them, and it'll all be doubly encrypted. So you end up with your own personal, private, 100% private library of all of your information. So instead of it being scattered everywhere where you don't know where it is, you now have it. And that, of course, is enshrined in the new GDPR as well, as we know, data portability. But lots of companies have allowed you to do this for years. So even the companies you might criticize, like Facebook and others, have allowed you to get your data back, and we've been merrily doing it for years as trials and everything else to prove you can have your data. So you can have all of your information in one library that you own and control, everything. Every purchase, every health record, or your genome, your finances, everything. You own it. Now here's the point. If you own all of that data, first of all, you can do more with it yourself. So you can see the data, anything you want, anything you've ever done. You can search it at any time. When did I last have a vaccination? How much have I spent with Amazon? Which is always the answer, is far too much. What did I do last year? Right? What restaurant did I go to? You can do all of that yourself and get insights from it. But now let's think about businesses. So today, businesses are busy trying to get data behind you by tracking or buying it, whatever. It's expensive. It's thin. It's not a very big picture of you. It's 30 to 50% wrong because of data staling and misassociation. It's poor, basically. But they do something with it whilst invading your privacy. But hold on a moment. You've now got the best data about you than anyone else. So why wouldn't the business come to you with a consent mechanism DigiMe happens to put in place and say, hello, Bob, could I have some of your data for this value exchange? I'm going to help you stay healthy, or I'm going to provide you a loan, or I'll just give you some exciting information about music, whatever it may be. Because you have the best data, rich data, wider across all your data, deeper in time, 100% accurate, single sourced. Well, of course they should do that. So let's think of an example. So if I want to go and get a bank loan to buy a car, I am actually thinking of buying a car and I will need a bank loan. They'll look at me and they'll say, well, Julian, you've got a very poor credit reference because Experian doesn't know enough about you because you've not borrowed any money recently and everything else. So I say, but really, trust me, I'm very good. So the bank can now say to me, well, Julian, can I see 5 years' worth of all of your financial information? That's a lot to give away, but if I really want the loan and I trust the bank, I can say yes. And my DigiMe or whatever app will be doing this as well will then pass that information to the bank purely for that purpose. Explicit informed consent just for that purpose. The bank can munch that data and say, yes, Julian, I'll give you that loan. That's something we couldn't do before we owned our data. Now that's crazy that we can't do that today, but now we can. But it's even better than that, because if you think about that 5 years' worth of data, there may be some purchases in there that I wasn't 100% happy with. Maybe I did a few things I shouldn't have done. Maybe the bank's automatic processes won't notice it, but I still might not like giving it to them. The bank, on the other hand, doesn't necessarily want to receive that data because they've got to store it, keep it secure, make sure that the wrong people don't see it, and God help them if they actually get it hacked because their reputation will go. So we can do something different now. They could ask me to download their bank app onto my phone and say, could the bank app see the 5 years' worth of data just on your phone? And then it will calculate the credit score and only send the credit score back to the bank. They get what they want, which is a completely accurate record of everything in terms of the credit score. I've shared a load of information, but I haven't really. I've only actually shared my resultant credit score. So by that way, we're way off the seesaw, aren't we? We're sharing more with much, much more privacy, purely because I own the data and the processing can come to the data. And I could even go further. So insurance companies are interested. And you say, why would an insurance company be interested in this process? Because of course they want to know you had a heart attack and they're going to charge you more. They don't want to do that. They're not actually allowed by law. So they've got to have pools of insurance. Maybe it's so they can manage claims better. Might be. But actually think about a health and a life insurance. The biggest cost to them is claims. It's you, me, being unhealthy. Now, they don't do anything to keep us healthy today, but what if they could? Could they with this, if you own your data? Well, actually, it's very easy. It's been proven in major studies, a big one called Open Notes in the States with now 6 million people on it and others, that if you actually see your own health data, that which the GP generally keeps today, you engage with it, you will be healthier because we get more involved. And that's before they can give you advice, before we can have apps that can use that data to help manage conditions, before we could have our genomic data in our own libraries and you could have stuff which is exactly tailored to you. So just by putting an app on your phone, asking you to allow that app to see your health data, but no data leaving your phone at all, a health insurance company can keep you healthier and dramatically reduce their costs. But that's 100% privacy. So we're way off the seesaw, right? I'm sharing everything about me, but nobody else gets to see it. Now, there are innumerable such use cases, and I'll happily talk to you about a lot of them. This is what we call the Internet of Me, where you're at the center of your digital life, owning and controlling your data. It is live today. People are building apps on top of what we're doing. It's rolling out, and you'll see others, right? Cozy Cloud will be up a bit later. They have a similar solution. All you need to do is move where the data is held, a copy of it, you own all of it, you will have the best data, and people will come to you. We can do more with our data and with greater privacy. And that's all we need to do. And think about it in business terms. It's only what businesses have done for years. If I want a stock control program to help me with stock management, I'm not going to give all my data away. I'll get the stock program to come and work on my data. So we just treat ourselves as little businesses. And it's very simple, and it's here today. Thank you very much. Won't bother with questions.
Thank you very much. Julian Ranger from DigiMe. Next up is Matt Sherratt from Projects by IF, Projects by IF. His talk will be Patterns of Consent, Rethinking How Services Ask for Data. Matt.
Hi, yeah. Can people hear me at the back? Yes, I can hear myself. Grand. Yeah, hello, I'm Matt. I'm from IF, and I'm here to talk, it's good, following on from the previous two, about consent. We think at IF, a lot of the work that we've done has touched on the fact that people don't really trust the services that we, the digital tools, products, services community, are making for them. And one of the big reasons for that is a pattern of consent called terms and conditions. But I'm going to kick off with a rattle through some of the things that have caused a lack of trust of late. First up is my friend Kayla. This is a doll that has conversations with the owner. The idea being that it's sort of sat happily in the nursery, chatting back and forth with children. It's been found to basically operate as a surveillance device, streaming data on a relatively insecure connection over to servers in the States and in Germany, and I think a few other countries now. It was banned around Christmas time. That came at the same time as IQ. Both of these toys were investigated by the Norwegian Consumer Council, who, as well as breaking down the technical spec of how they operated, also rattled through the terms and conditions for both of these toys and were able to dig out, well, where is this data going? How much of it is being captured? How much is actually relevant to the value exchange taking place? It's not just toys, obviously. Samsung smart TVs and many other smart TVs are basically the sort of grown-up versions of the surveillance devices in our homes, followed up by tools like Alexa. The thing with all of this stuff is not necessarily that the technologies behind them are bad or implemented in a sort of morally repugnant way. It's not wholly that. Partly it's a technical problem, but partly it's about rights. In every one of those examples and countless others, none of the people using the devices, or not none, very few of the people using the devices will ever be aware of exactly what they're giving up when they use them. And that's mostly down to the terms and conditions design pattern. We need to make trust as important to design as accessibility. We think that's basically the fundamental way of getting all product teams, all people building these services, as well as legislators, to understand the relationship and the nuance of people putting these devices in their homes. Here's the little bit where I tell you what IF are. We are a design studio. Our thing is helping organizations build services or products that people trust. We've kind of got three strands to our work. One is about helping companies design services that empower people, so that most of the power relationship is down at the sort of user's place rather than the organization's place. The second thing is pursuing work that helps make digital rights a mainstream issue. And we just did a report for Consumers International gathering different approaches to putting digital rights into legislation. And the other bit of our work is consent models and devising new ways of getting consent and establishing a trust relationship with users. And they all interrelate. We've done a bunch of projects in the last year and a half with some big organizations and some small organizations, some that are about putting services out in the wild and some that are more sort of speculative art projects. But fundamentally, they all explore those three things. And we also have a philosophy in-house of learning by making. So we aren't just helping someone devise a policy position. We're building services or prototypes of services that actually help illustrate what will that look like in the wild? How will it really exist in the world? And what we keep finding and keep coming back to is that the design patterns for trust and consent simply aren't good enough for the increasingly complex services that live in the world. You think about any standard terms and conditions document, and you're rattling through something that's roughly the same length as War and Peace. It's written in deliberately obfuscatory language that only a lawyer can unpick. But even if you go through all of these and rewrite them so that they are human readable, or so that a child could read them, which is what happened to Instagram's terms and conditions recently, what's taking place is fundamentally the same. Your rights are being removed. You are having the burden of risk placed on you by an organization so that they can do with data about you basically whatever they like. It can be passed on, resold, reprocessed. Things like GDPR are directly a response to this. But what the terms and conditions pattern is extremely good at doing is absorbing new legislation and reflecting the same normality back to users. That's what we saw happen with the cookie law. That was something designed to increase transparency and understanding of how the internet works. And that all just got absorbed into terms and conditions and spat back as the cookie banner, a design pattern that hasn't helped people understand how the internet really works. So to start thinking about how we develop new ones, we first started out building a catalog and understanding what mechanisms we have for having moments of consent now. And it's 30-odd things gathered on a page at catalog.projectsbyif.com, and this first version of it is straight up an illustration of things that exist or could exist in the wild today. So one of those things is active request, where a relatively granular bit of information is asked for at point of use to say, do you consent to your location being shared now to appear on a map? That kind of a thing. Another one would be control of physical object, where a token, whether it be a kind of a key or an RFID or whatever it be, unlocks a kind of service or unlocks a tracking behavior. And that's the sort of thing you see in YubiKey or with some of the bank entry things, that it's the object, having possession and using the object is about showing consent to a service. And something that we've worked on in-house is the data licenses model. So that's something where at the earliest time that you use a service or product, you'd be able to say, okay, for this kind of data, I am happy for it to be used for this kind of purpose and shared in this way, if at all, or resold in this way, if at all. This is very similar to the kind of Creative Commons license that you might create for bits of media, but we're thinking of it as something that would apply to data. And of all of the licenses that we collected, like none of them are perfect. They all have different holes and flaws, but really we gathered them all so that we could kind of point at a thing to prove terms and conditions aren't the only way of doing it. There's a multiplicity of things, and we need a multiplicity of things if we're going to enter this brave new world of products and services in our lives, in our phones, in our homes, in our workplaces, generating data about what we do. We can't just sign it all away in one go. Where we've gotten to is that we don't think just listing them is enough. And to go any further, we need help. Like, we're a small design studio, mostly working in a commercial context. We are like 12 people at peak. If we were to just sit there and go, here is the new way of doing things, it would be as flawed as just carrying on with the way things are now. But what we are doing is setting up a meetup that we want to be able to take to other places to start discussing what new methods might actually be appropriate, what kind of circumstances they might surface in, how we could work with different legislators and different policy professionals to explore what prototyping might look like in the context of policy development, and all of that stuff. And we also think this will turn into useful tools for product teams. And at the moment, we're in a phase of like going around and asking for help with all of this stuff. And that's really the point of me being here now. So we want to hold regular meetups. The first one is in a couple of weeks' time in London. We've got another one booked in for May for that. We can't stay in London. We need to take this out into the world. So if you've got local communities or groups of people who are interested in this space, get in touch. I am Matthew@projectsbyif.com, but you know, hit our website. There's an email address there for the rest of the team. But we want to see this go to other places and facilitate this conversation in a bunch of different parts of the world. We also want to start publishing new patterns. So that list of 30-odd things on catalog, it's not the whole of the ways that we ask for consent in the world. And there are also other speculative approaches that we're keen to see, like, well, how are you testing these? What could exist? And the first step is getting up on there. You know, it might turn into a book or something down the line. We don't really know. We don't know what's useful. We'll test it as we go. But definitely cataloging things is the first step. And we want to turn that into tools for product teams. That's kind of the critical thing for us. We want to get to a place where anyone working at product level or at the data control level has a bunch of stuff that they can help understand, like what methods of design can we use to improve the state of the art for our users. Projectsbyif.com/meetup if you want to find out more about what we're doing or sign up there. But basically, we want to build more patterns that empower people and get them back out into the world. Because our thing is that trust is about design. It's not about compliance. It can't be the bit that happens right at the end of a service just before you go live. It has to be baked in from inception right the way through to delivery and maintaining it from there on in. That's basically me. Thank you very much. I'm around after this for any chat.
Thank you very much. Matt Charette, Projects by IF. So while you guys are getting up on stage, one of the great digital organizations that is native to Europe is the Open Knowledge Foundation. It's an incredible organization. And joining us today are Raoul Plummer and Emilia Hjelm from Finland, at least currently. Their talk is about My Data, Advancing Human-Centric Personal Data. Over to you.
Hey, thank you. Nice to be here waiting for our slides.
The anticipation is killing us all. And, and I'll just mention to people that the left and right screens are properly focused, so if you can't see the top, just look left or look right.
Right, so it's about My Data, which is a Nordic model for human-centered personal data management. Yeah, that's us. We're both from Open Knowledge Finland. Can't see all the slides, only partly.
But the point is, Open Knowledge Finland is part of the Open Knowledge International network that has over 40 groups in 40 countries and 2,000 people and really cool initiatives, so you should definitely check it out.
Yep. It was found in Cambridge 13 years ago.
I'm really sorry about the slides, but let's try not to.
Yeah, and this is something we thought out because we're very short on time. The presentation is quite long. This is where you can post questions and comments, and we'll answer them later on today.
on Twitter.
And there's a person right now there checking it out, can already start answering questions. Right, so personal data, it's becoming a new asset class. It's an extremely valuable resource. People say that personal data is like the oil, like a new oil industry. And there are nice ways to extract it as well as bad ways. Personal data is everywhere. We are getting accustomed to the Internet of Things, which is basically in everything surrounding us, and it's just becoming more and more enveloping. Basically, soon enough, we'll take a shower and it's posted on the Internet. It's extremely profitable business as well. They estimate that the value of the whole data, selling and buying of data, is worth 1 trillion euros by the end of 2020. And it's, the potential versus the realization. Who gets the benefits? What happens to privacy? These are really the key issues around my data.
So basically, trust is a must. Some of the potential value can be, it's like two-thirds can be undone if the customers don't trust the companies that they use their personal data in a fair way. And by a report by Orange, it says that 78% of their clients said that they don't really, really trust the way that internet companies are using their data.
And who can blame them?
So it comes to 3 points. One is that the trust at the moment is broken. We don't have trust in the personal data business, basically. But then we have this potential 1 trillion euro market coming up. But in order to do that, we need to have a new solution for how we handle the personal data management business. And our solution is to do it by interoperability and new practices.
My data is to bring the trust back into this system.
Yeah, so what's the real definition of my data by us is that it's a human-centered approach in personal data management that combines both the industry need to data with digital human rights. And this is like the situation now, the API economy. There is no like central infrastructure, so the data just flows somewhere and then somewhere, and nobody is like in control of what happens. And this is one possible future where these walled gardens like Google or Facebook or Apple or Microsoft take the role of the hub that collects the personal information from different sources into their service and then makes the customer dependent on their service.
Make no mistake, that's the dystopian future.
Yeah. But this is what the MyData approach wants to advance, is that the human is put in the center of the data. So like you could be the hub, you could own your data, you could get it from different services, and then you could control who sees it or whatever you want to do with it. It's about putting the individual both as the connection point and the control point so that you can manage the consent of giving your data away like to third parties. And these are the principles of my data, that it's human-centric, human has the right to data, right to control, right to privacy, and there's also the usability of data. It needs to be clean, it needs to be machine-readable, we need to have open formats, APIs, standards, and then we need to have the open business environment, which means that services need to be working together and not like building data silos and service locks so that you can't get out of the service because they own your data and you can't extract it.
All we need is standardization, and we all know how easy that is.
This is a really major change. Thinking about going mobile instead of like calling landlines and thinking of having personal computers instead of these huge, huge calculation halls. So we have benefits for the users. The users get better services because the services get enriched from the user's own data, from different sources. It also can mean better privacy because they have the transparency on who collects data, what does it look like, where it comes from, and the control to the data flow. And they can get also better insight to their own things, like health, because they see much more what they didn't see before because it was in a black box. And for businesses, it means that a customer relationship gets stronger because you can give services to customers that they really need. You don't need to guess what does it mean that they did this search. You can just use their data in like a transparent way, both ways. And for society, it means that we can, in parallel, develop digital rights and innovate new services and enable business growth. Because at the moment, if you are a startup and then you go to a big retail chain and say that we would like to use our clients' shopping data for our small startup application, they won't even talk to you. But if you could turn it around and have the user get their own data from the retail and then give it to the startup, then we can really enforce having really cool new services based on like data mashup from different sources.
People could select specific data that they want to give out for research purposes and statistical analysis, so on.
And this is our more a bit technical model, which is the operator model. The idea is that the individual slash data subject slash account owner owns an account, like a teleoperator account, through which she can control the flow of data, only like the consents, and then those data sources can exchange data based on this consent. And it should be as easy to revoke that consent than it is to give it in the first place. So anytime you can say that I don't want any more that this service gets my this and that data, so then you just turn it off. This has something to do with the General Data Protection Regulation, which I hope you have already heard of, but it makes my data possible because it says that the data subjects need to have their own data in a machine-readable format so that they can exchange service providers. So that's like the minimum thing to have in my data.
And the GDPR will change some business models of current internet companies as well. So my data is a way forward for them as well.
So my data and GDPR have some common overlapping aims, like enhance privacy, but then my data has also the aim of get new business going on. In Finland, we have very cool things going on. We have industrial alliance with telcos and banks and retail chains and startups, which is facilitated by the Ministry of Transport and Communications in Finland. Then we have public collaboration with the government in its digitalization spearhead project. And then the Finnish Population Center is now planning a My Data pilot as part of their work as well.
Yeah, in Finland, they've actually mentioned open data as an important initiative for the Finnish society. Like, they've put that in the government program.
I have a few call to actions for you. One is that we're having in August a huge conference on My Data in Estonia and in Finland. And I ask you to join our movement. What we are doing is to build a community there. We have some flyers over there in the table, so please take them. And then we have a working group around this subject in Facebook to share. You can join that as well. And we have published a white paper in English about this My Data thing, so you can go and look it up. And the links are hard, but check the My Data Rights hashtag on Twitter. I have posted the link to the slides there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Raoul Plummer, Amelia Helm from Open Knowledge Finland. And finally, and I will say miraculously on schedule, I don't know that I've ever emceed something like this that has actually stuck to the schedule, but we are there. So thank you to all the speakers. Tristan from Cozy Cloud. Tristan.
Hi, everyone. Let's pray together for the slides to be in the right format. Cross fingers, everyone. One, two, three. Nice. All right. So why do we need a decentralized internet, and how do we do that? My name is Tristan Ito. I'm a French citizen. I hope my accent does not betray me too much. I'm Tristan at cozycloud.cc, and if you like centralized services such as Twitter, I'm at Nito, N-I-T-O-T. I'm the Chief Product Officer of Cozy Cloud. I've been an entrepreneur and an activist. I've spent 17 years with the Mozilla project, bringing Firefox to Europe. I wrote a book about mass surveillance that was released 6 months ago that is selling pretty well. And I'm now an executive at Cozy.io, which is a personal cloud in open source for the masses, hopefully. So as you probably know, we all use three computers. We use personal computers, we use a smartphone, and we use a third one that we do not see, which is called the cloud, because, well, we see clouds, but we can't touch them, at least that's... And the reason why we use cloud is for syncing the two other computers. Personal computer and smartphone, you take a photo on your smartphone, is sent to your computer. It's also for backing up your smartphone and personal computer, and also software as a service. So if you use Gmail or Google Maps, you use software as a service. You think it's in the cloud, but it's actually a software as a service. And the truth is, there is no cloud. The cloud, by definition, is someone else's computer. And we cannot repeat this enough, because people think they own this third computer. Actually, they do not. They put data into silos. So a silo is to store grain, if you don't know what it is. And the issue with these silos is that data is centralized around algorithms that provide us with services. So you Google, you have Amazon, you have Facebook, you have Apple, and you have a couple of others too. The issue is, once your data is there, you have no control of what kind of software runs there. The software is proprietary, you'll have the freedom to change it, and of course there is no room for free software. The funny thing is, they probably run free software, but because you can't change it, you can't update it, you can't audit it, it's like it was not free. Free as in open source, I mean. And so these gears here are here to symbolize the algorithms that are in these silos and that you cannot change. Here is Edward Snowden, which in June 2013 had, came with revelations, and he has given to journalists hundreds of thousands of documents about governments, English and, of course, American, what they do, and which is illegal, which is basically doing mass surveillance on citizens, despite the fact that it's against their constitution. And in there, if there is one thing we need to take away from the Snowden revelation, is that the fact that we centralize all of our data in these silos, it makes economically possible to do mass surveillance for the governments. And mass surveillance is pretty bad. I would love to give you a lecture about mass surveillance and how toxic it is for our democracies. I really encourage you to watch Glenn Greenwald's TED Talk, which is called Why Privacy Matters. Glenn is one of the journalists who were with Snowden when he did the revelations. And it's really amazing. But basically, the thing is, if you know you are under surveillance, you tend to self-censor. That's the one thing you need to remember. And I would like to give two quotes. One is from Lawrence Lessig, which is code is law. That's the code that computer scientists write or engineers write is the thing that decides what you can and cannot do in your daily life. In the 21st century, code is law. And there is something else that goes with it, is that architecture is politics. The way you architecture the machines and the services around you is deciding what you can and cannot do with these services. So about these architecture, what I want to do is, instead of going centralizing, like the Google and Facebook of the world want us to do, I want to decentralize. I want to build a decentralized internet that empowers citizens. So instead of putting all of our data into the hands of a few giants, I want everyone in this room and everyone in the world to own a personal cloud. Based on seven principles, I won't go through all of them. If there is one to remember, it must be running open source software. Because if it's not running open source software, you cannot see what goes in it. And it's a different kind of a prison. So you need to be running open source software to know what is being done with your data. So this is the Cozy Cloud icon. And what you first do is you connect your devices to your cloud, your personal cloud, so that you can sync files between your different devices and have a backup on your cloud. The second step is to use connectors that we provide that can enable you to connect to your bank, your e-commerce site, your service provider, your mobile service provider, etc., and gather data onto your personal cloud. And then you have all of your data in a single place, which is secure. It can be physically in your home, if this is what you want. You can buy one of these cheap computers. It's a Raspberry Pi. It's roughly 50 euros. And you can have your own data at home if you want to. If you don't want to, you can host it somewhere. If you're not happy there, you can move your data and your services to another hosting provider or back home on such a computer. So you have freedom in moving your data and your services from where you want. So you have more services and less friction. And finally, you can install vendor applications that can interact locally with your data without being allowed to collect the data. They do not get a copy of it. They can work on your data. All they can do is just take a result of it with your consent. It's your choice to do that or not to do that. So let's do a quick demo because it's easier when you see the product. So this is a personal cloud running Cozy Cloud, so open source and free software. First, you log in. You will notice that it doesn't ask for a username because it's a personal cloud. If you have the password, you're the person. It's like your smartphone. Your smartphone doesn't ask you who you are. It asks you the password so you can show you are the owner of the smartphone. It's the same here. It's you're the only owner of this personal cloud. So you type your password, and you take it into a home page with applications. You will see here that import from Google. I think we want to have an import from Facebook and such. And the GDPR is going to be fantastic for that because it forces data portability. We have several applications, and I'll show you a couple of these. First is file synchronization. I can see the files from here. I can see them on my cell phone. I can see them on my PC. The other app is Contacts. So here's a list of my, here is a list of my contacts with details for each of them. A calendar with my data on it. And a personal finance manager where I have connected to my bank and downloaded all my banking information. So as you can see, this is a trial. It's fake. I don't have all of this money on my bank account, unfortunately. What's really cool is that I can use, hyperlinks here. If I click here, because I have the data coming from my email, this is the train ticket that I bought with this money. So I can use my data in a much better way, access it without friction, from my bank account to my PDF, showing this train ticket. Another example here is, this is the detailed billing information from my mobile service provider. You know, this mobile thing, you get a long, long list of numbers and time and an amount of money spent for that phone call, but it's totally useless because it's just a list of phone numbers. And if you're like me, you don't know who uses which one phone number. But the good thing is, because this is on my personal cloud, it also has access to my contact details. And so I can cross the data, and from the detailed billing information plus my contacts, I can make a list of the top 5 people that cost me money when I call them. Why do I spend so much money on them? Or the top 5 people I spend the most time on. Oh, I didn't realize I'm spending like 4 hours a month with my aunt. Maybe I should see her more and, I don't know, something like that, actionable data. This is pretty much it. The data is running out. The time is running out, sorry. That's pretty much it. So if you have any questions, I'll be with you right away. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tristan. So that's our lightning talks on privacy and personal data. Thank you so much to all the speakers. Greatly appreciated. Very interesting talks. 15-minute break. We have our fourth series of lightning talks starting in 15 minutes.